We're here today to talk about the biggest and arguably the most obvious Easter egg that everybody missed in Leave the World Behind.
We know you've all seen Leave the World Behind and heard about the Easter eggs like 1619 on the radio dial, the ship named the White Lion, and the hamlet where the vacation home is located being called Point Comfort.
All clear references to the indelible stain on America's history.
Folks were so proud that they noticed or were told about these obviously placed clues, to which the typical response was, "That's deep."
But the truth is, noticing these Easter eggs is the low-hanging fruit of the deliberately placed breadcrumbs in the film. This was easy work for anyone paying attention.
But you've missed the one Easter egg that is staring you right in the face that makes all of these seemingly random historical references make sense.
What you should be asking yourself is, what does it all mean? Why all the hidden messages in Leave the World Behind?
Maybe it's just entertainment, but maybe it's more than that. Back when our ancestors were held captive and they couldn't speak openly about what they knew, understood, or their plans for the future, they told their stories through songs and artwork like quilts with hidden meanings.
For our people, these messages were instructional on how to survive, but more importantly, how to find freedom.
So why would writer-director Sam Esmail, along with the first Black president of the United States of America, who used to be a constitutional law professor and an ex-first lady who is also a legal mind, produce a film with all of these hidden messages and references to this country's horrible past?
What if we told you that all of these Easter eggs in the film are intended to be both cautionary and instructional, calling those who have eyes to see and ears to hear to understand the lessons of the past in order to heed the writing on the wall in today's climate of volatile opposing ideologies?
Well, that's exactly what we're telling you. And we'll explain and fully break down the most important Easter egg that you missed and what it all means in the context of this film and beyond.
I'm Height.
And I'm Cherie.
And you've discovered Axiom Amnesia.
A lot of you requested that we cover this film, and I can't wait for us to talk about it. But first, we want to thank all of the supporters who helped to make this video possible. If you want your name to appear alongside these contributors, make a one-time donation via Cash App or click the thanks button on this video, or you can head on over to patreon.com/axiomamnesia or become a channel member by clicking the join button to enjoy all of the benefits of becoming a monthly subscriber.
For those of you who haven't seen the film, Leave the World Behind is about a New York City family of four who decides to take a weekend vacation and winds up sharing the Airbnb type of rental property with the owners of the house, a father and daughter during what is unfolding as an impending apocalyptic situation on Long Island, New York in the United States.
You should also know that the film is based on a 2020 novel by Rumman Alam. The film was directed by Sam Esmail and, as we mentioned, was produced by Barack and Michelle Obama, along with their production company, Higher Ground Productions.
So what exactly was the Obama's involvement in the film? According to the director and scriptwriter, Sam Esmail, the ex-president of the United States had some involvement with reviewing and making suggestions for edits to the script.
He was giving me notes at the script stage, multiple drafts, including, you know, post, rough cuts.
The Obamas became involved in this project after the book was already written, so any of the messages coming specifically from them might be found in the differences between the novel and the film.
He was really involved.
This isn't a full breakdown video, so we won't cover everything significant that happens in the film. Our main goal with this video is to lay enough foundation so that you understand this major Easter egg in the context of the pertinent clues within the film.
And go ahead and put a comment if you want us to do a full breakdown of this film. Give us a comment. I also want to add that theft of our content and ideas is running rampant. So if you do see people peddling our theories, please feel free to tag us. And also, if you want to discuss our theories, all we ask is that you give proper attribution. Just say, "Hey, Axiom Amnesia said," and don't pretend like you developed our theories off of the top of your head.
First, let's talk about the Easter egg many of you have noticed and tie together their significance. Then we'll get into the huge Easter egg that you all missed and its meaning.
And before we get into this next part, just know these are deep spoilers. So if you haven't seen the film and you don't want spoilers, you might want to check out and then come back once you've seen the film. On the way to their vacation rental, we see the all-American Sanford family, Amanda, played by Julia Roberts, the mother, Clay, played by Ethan Hawke, the father, and the son and daughter, Archie and Rose. The first subtle sign of trouble to come is when the internet to Rose's iPad loses signal and she can't finish watching the episode of Friends in which she's totally engrossed.
They're all deeply focused on their various individual activities when we see a road sign that directs drivers to stay straight in the left lane to head to Fort Mose or to take exit 76 in the right lane to go to Point Comfort.
Neither Fort Mose nor Point Comfort exist on Long Island, New York. However, Fort Mose in St. Augustine, Florida, is the site of the first legally sanctioned free African community in the U.S. By 1738, over 100 enslaved Africans escaped the British colonies in Georgia and South Carolina and headed south in what became Florida, where they were given asylum in exchange for converting to Catholicism and a term of military service for the Spanish.
Point Comfort, where the family is actually headed, is a fictional place in the film, but the real Point Comfort of note is in Virginia.
Fort Monroe in Hampton, Virginia, has played a remarkable role in the history of our nation.
In late August 1619, 20 to 30 enslaved Africans landed at Point Comfort, today's Hampton, Virginia, aboard the English privateer ship White Lion.
It was the site of the first slave ships to land in the New World.
Keep the year 1619 and the name White Lion in mind, because they'll both come up later. What were folks doing in Old Point Comfort back in the day? They were dealing in the trade of living human beings who had been stolen from Africa. Ironically, nearly 250 years later, runaway slaves found freedom at the same location, Point Comfort, at the then Union-occupied military installation known as Fort Monroe.
During the Civil War, almost 250 years later, Fort Monroe also became a refuge for slaves that were escaping from the South and helped create the environment in which Abraham Lincoln was able to sign that document up there, the Emancipation Proclamation.
So Point Comfort was both an entry into enslavement and a refuge from it years later.
We are going to continue this legacy, making Fort Monroe a national monument.
So before the Sanford family can even make it to their vacation, we have one sign on the road that leads to freedom and another sign that leads to captivity, and they're headed toward the latter. Exit 76 to Point Comfort, as in the year 1776, also shouldn't be lost on you, because that is the second time the number 76 had been seen in the film so far. The first time we see 76 was on the cup in Clay and Amanda's bedroom. It was a Philadelphia 76ers basketball team logo. These are clear references to the year 1776. By issuing the Declaration of Independence adopted by the Continental Congress on July 4, 1776, the 13 American colonies severed their political connections to Great Britain.
It's a cute little town. Actually, I think they call it a hamlet. That's how cute it is. It's a lot closer to the city.
At this point in the car, we've heard Amanda on the phone talking about the town that is basically a hamlet, which in the United States refers to a small settlement that has no central place of worship and no village hall, and is perhaps separated from other settlements by a countryside or farmland. So the family takes exit 76 and continues on their way as Kool & the Gang's song Misled blares these lyrics from the radio. Baby, baby, what's your claim to fame? Got me out of bed, heard you call my name. What's this crazy place you want to take me to? Tell me, what's the price if I go with you? Tell me what's the price if I go with you? My heart, my soul, my love, is that the goal? It's a thrill, then I will. Hey, misled, won't you be for real? Misled, misled, and misled is repeated. Isn't it interesting that while the Sanfords are heading to their vacation, a song talking about being misled is playing?
Yes. So after the family arrives to this beautiful rental home, Amanda is exploring the place. We hear the unforgettable opening to Blackstreet's song, Never Gonna Let You Go.
I forgot what a cut this was back in the day. The horn at the beginning of the song is like a horn to get your attention that something important is coming. We did some digging and realized that the synth horn at the beginning of the song sounds eerily like a slowed down military bugle call. You ever heard a bugle call? I'm sure you have. You've been in the military.
Yes, I heard them many of taps and and morning colors.
What do y'all think? Does it kind of sound like this slowed down bugle call?
After the introductory synth, we are lulled into nostalgia by this passionate yet clearly dysfunctional love song. But when you realize that everything in this film seems to be pointing back to a darker time in America's history, that synth horn at the beginning of the song really does sound a lot like a military bugle call when you slow it down.
When you begin to examine the lyrics to this Backstreet love song, as a viewer, you might not want to believe what the song is saying. But in the historical context of captive people hearing the words, never going to let you go away, you belong to me and I'm never going to let you go, and I regret the moment when I heard you say you don't want no part of me no more, and then other references to ignoring the tears that have been cried, et cetera, et cetera. Well, these words take on a whole new meaning in the context of ownership of another human being and denying people of the right to freedom and self-determination. In the song, the woman is told the guy singing that she wants him out of her life because of how he has mistreated her. She's tried to leave, but the audacity that he tells her that he's never going to let her go, regardless of what she wants and that she belongs to him. It's not all that hard to compare this to the dynamic that existed between the individuals who owned other folks, owned in air quotes, of course, and the people who were subject to mistreatment. So the so-called owners probably did feel some affinity or kinship to the enslaved on some level, but it didn't stop them from holding people who didn't want to be held and exploiting their labor against their will solely for their own benefit, financial and otherwise.
Also, when the lyric is sung, you don't want no part of me no more, it can be interpreted as this idea to preserve the Union from the Northern's perspective leading up to the Civil War. You don't want to be a part of me no more, alluding to Southern secession.
That's a definite connection.
But back to the Sanford family, Amanda decides to head to the store for some food. And in case you doubted that Point Comfort was indeed the name of the little hamlet, it's printed right there on the front of the grocery store, Point Comfort Marketplace. So we do know which exit they took. What's interesting is the word choice of marketplace versus market, supermarket, grocery store. A marketplace is an open space where a market is or was formerly held in town. This is a subtle difference, but one of the reasons this store is referenced as a marketplace is because of what and whom they were selling at the marketplace back in the day. Just imagine, there could have been an auction block right where Amanda went to buy groceries for her family.
Later in the day, the Sanfords decide to head to the beach, and we see that the name of the beach is Charleston Harbor Beach. This is yet another clue. You've probably guessed that Charleston Harbor Beach isn't a real place on Long Island, New York. But Charleston Harbor is a real place in history that still exists today in South Carolina. In fact, over 40% of all enslaved Africans who came to North America through the transatlantic slave trade arrived through Charleston Harbor in South Carolina.
Charleston Harbor is also where the Civil War began at Fort Sumter.
It's getting closer.
What is?
Ship.
So the Sanfords continue with their day at Charleston Harbor Beach when a giant ship that the daughter Rose first spots in the distance somehow comes ashore.
Jesus, Archie, let's go.
And the family has to run to avoid being hit by the vessel that is aptly named the White Lion. The same ship we told you about earlier that brought the first enslaved Africans to Point Comfort, Virginia in 1619.
So just to recap, in this film, the Sanfords are on a fictional harbor beach that really exists in South Carolina, and the slave ship that brought the first enslaved Africans to America, the White Lion, has just slammed ashore in the fall of 2022. But the family shakes it off and heads back to the house, where they discover that they still have no cell phone service and the cable satellite TV doesn't seem to be working either.
Later on, the kids are in the bed. Amanda and Clay are playing Jenga at about 11:17 at night. And then two black folks, G.H. and his daughter Ruth Scott, show up at the door, claiming that this is their house and they're hoping to stay the night after experiencing a blackout in New York City and driving to their summer home.
This is our house. I'm the Georgie email.
As the four people talk, Amanda and Clay inside and G.H. and Ruth standing outside, it's clear that this is one family versus another as they try to work all of this out.
This is your house. You want to stay here, but we're staying here.
It is like our house.
Amanda is immediately suspicious of G.H. and Ruth and is upset when G.H. suggests that they stay for the night.
We could absolutely refund you your money.
You come in here and talk about refunding our money. I think I need to call the company.
And he was even willing to refund half of the money that they paid for the rental in exchange for allowing them to sleep in the basement.
You know, there's an in-law suite. We could stay downstairs.
Downstairs?
50%.
Clay takes the $1,000 cash from G.H., and he's much more sympathetic about the situation, and he agrees to let them stay the night in the basement.
I can give you $1,000 now for the night. That should cover almost half of what you're paying for the weekend.
Amanda and Clay argue over this.
It really doesn't seem like their house.
She doesn't believe that they are who they actually claim to be. And the optics of this scene reference servitude when G.H. is seen looking like a butler in a tux in his own home whilst serving drinks to Clay. And Ruth is also doing dishes around this same time. And later on, Amanda even suggests that G.H. and Ruth are not the owners again, but are instead the help trying to pull a scam on them.
Maybe he's the handyman. She's the housekeeper. The housekeeper always knows where the stash of money is.
Tensions are high between the four, with Amanda and Clay feeling entitled to stay in the place they've paid for. Meanwhile, G.H. tries to be nice, but is well aware that this is his house and he is in fact entitled to be there. Ruth is clearly annoyed by the interactions with the Sanfords. Ultimately, the Scotts wind up staying in the basement of their own home after an emergency broadcast alert blares over the TV and it becomes clear that something major is happening.
As G.H. and Ruth head downstairs to sleep in the basement of their own home, you can see that the basement sort of resembles the below decks of a ship with all of these wooden walls. And shout out to Canadian Prepper, because he's the first one that we heard mention this observation. So what we have here is an impending disaster, but we don't know the nature of what's exactly happening. Now we have these two families taking shelter inside this house that has clear references to being a ship of sorts. And this house is literally like an ark, the place where they're all going to take shelter from danger. Nevertheless, we cannot avoid the apparent hierarchy of the inhabitants of this house. When they go to sleep, we see that the white family is sleeping upstairs while the black family is preparing to sleep in the below decks-like basement of their own home, just like the help. Now, where have we seen an image like this before? And when you couple all of this with the fact that black bodies have been relegated to the below decks portion of this ship-looking basement, it's hard not to see the parallels between what's happening in the film and what happened to those kidnapped Africans on the White Lion ship.
So while Ruth and G.H. are preparing for bed, they sit down and have a conversation. But one thing that we do see in the basement, or the hull of the ship, is a map of the U.S. and it is broken into quadrants of two colors, green and red.
So the next day, nothing really has changed except there seems to be some alerts that Amanda's gotten to her phone and now she's upset.
Did you forget those people are still in our house? I trusted you to handle this.
And so Clay has promised Amanda that he will go to town and try to get help finding out what is going on with all of this supposed cyber attack and everything that's happening.
I will take care of this for us.
But while Clay is out looking for help, the only station that comes on briefly is station AM dial 1619. And we mentioned earlier that the year 1619 is significant, and that's because 1619 marks the beginning of the race-based bondage that defined the African-American experience with ships docking in Point Comfort, essentially in the English colonies.
So Clay gets lost, never actually makes it to town. He turns around on a road near a sign for Tawny Farms. Soon after this, Clay runs into a hysterical Latina woman who only speaks Spanish. He's confused and cannot understand her, ultimately deciding to abandon her on the side of the road, killing off as she runs alongside the vehicle as he picks up speed.
Why do you always laugh at that part
of
the movie?
That was the funniest scene in the movie.
Oh my gosh. It was sad, but it was crazy how he just peeled off. And I even saw some memes later on that showed his face as he had peeled off and was like, if I send you this, that means that I can't help you.
This woman may represent the United States' current immigration and migrant issues. Ultimately, people who have come to the United States for help and a better life are being turned away and abandoned. Today, it's even happening in so-called sanctuary cities as migrants are being bused from border states and dumped off with little regard for how their needs will be met.
X. And did you notice the slave quarters that everyone keeps calling a shed in the movie?
We were out by the shed yesterday. So
the shed? What shed?
The shed.
Because while Clay and GH are away from the home looking for help and answers and stuff like that, Archie and Rose wander into the woods and they begin exploring this wooden shack.
What's in that thing?
And so there are tools and other things that appear to be stored inside, but this structure doesn't seem to be clearly part of any of the surrounding homes' deliberately built property. And since there's no house, their closest neighbor is miles away. Presumably it would be part of this house, but it looks really old. Like, why is there a slave shack, slave quarters, in their backyard? Later in the film, when Rose is missing, Amanda and Ruth return to the slave quarters to look for her.
Yeah.
But nobody calls it a slave quarters. It's just like, oh, it's the shed, the shed.
While Amanda and Ruth are poolside, they're discussing Rose's obsession with the show Friends. Ruth admits that she's seen the show and comments that it is nostalgic for a time that never existed.
But it's almost nostalgic for a time that never existed.
Keeping in mind that this film is hinting hard at race relations and the American dream, as well as who is entitled to it, Root's comment about nostalgia for a time that never existed seems to draw a striking parallel to the slogan of the people who wear those red hats. The idea they push is to make the country great again, but if you were an inhabitant of the White Lion or similar vessels down there in the halls, or you have lived through Jim Crow or other forms of systemic racism and sexism, you can only conclude that the place was only great for the people who benefited from the exploitation and denial of self-determination from entire groups of people.
So as this film progresses and the disaster keeps intensifying, the mural of the ocean in the bedroom changes multiple times throughout the film. It goes from calm seas with a few waves to these choppy and turbulent seas as the film gets more intense. And this really enforces the idea that the house is serving as an ark of survival for the Scotts and the Sanfords, while clearly reminding us that they are at sea.
Eventually, everyone realizes that there's been a cyber attack and there are loud noises and possible radiation that are harming people. In the end, Amanda and Ruth see an attack on the city. And a bunch of stuff happens that leads us to the final scenes of the movie, in which GH explains to Clay and Archie,
without a clear enemy or motive, people would start turning on each other,
that he believes that what they've witnessed is a civil war.
A coup d'etat. Civil war.
Or potentially orchestrated by an outside agitator.
We've watched this film 10 to 12 times, probably honestly like 20 times since it was released. And the one thing we kept coming back to was that we've gotten all of these Easter eggs in our lap. But what is it all supposed to mean? What is the significance in the context of the film? What is this message that we're supposed to take away?
Of course, there's the obvious message of disaster preparedness and beware of speculations when you don't know what's happening. But surely there has to be more than this here because of all of those references back to that dark time in American history. So we had to go back to take a closer look to figure all of this out.
Full disclosure, we have not read the book yet because we want to analyze the film as a standalone work rather than being influenced by what happened in the book. We did look into a couple of the differences between the novel and the film. First, in the book, Ruth is G.H.'s wife, and in the movie, she's his daughter. And also, G.H. and Ruth's last name was changed from Washington in the novel to Scott in the film. Ruth tells us that G.H.'s first name is George when they first arrive at their home, and they're outside of the door asking if they can come in and spend the night.
I'm G.H. G.H. Scott.
He's George. That's how it reads in his email.
And so the immediate thought was that it was a complete mistake to change the last name to Scott because of the mere irony of this black man who's wealthy and everything and successful being named George Washington, the slave-owning first president of the United States of America. Why in the world would they change the name to Scott?
At the same time, we realized that we needed to dig further into these names to make heads or tails of what was really going on in this film. Is this movie really about a cyber attack or something else? Interviews with the cast and director kept reminding us that the film is about the people and the relationships we see them form. That's from their perspectives.
At its core, this film is about two families, the Sanfords and the Scotts, who are trying to figure out who is a rightful citizen and owner of this house, among other things, with full entitlements of citizenship versus the people who are only entitled to be subjugated by this ruling class. Who will get to sleep upstairs and who will be relegated to the servant quarters?
And we tell you all the time that class is about far more than how much money you have. Class is about the level of power you innately have as you start to play the game of people politics. Class is the cards you're dealt before you ever have to make a decision about what cards you'll actually play and whether you'll have to play any cards at all to win or maintain your position.
In this film, the Scotts are black, but they are of a higher class than the Sanfords. G.H., his wife and daughter, are rubbing elbows with the elites, while Amanda and Clay are simply middle class with race advantages. This is interesting because race often dictates socioeconomic class due to systemic design. Nevertheless, the way the rules of race politics played out in this house dictate that the rightful owners of the house, G.H. and Ruth, be relegated to living like second-class citizens under the suspicious eye of Amanda, a white middle-class woman who has merely rented their home for the weekend. And let's not forget that Amanda refers to the, quote, people in our house multiple times within the movie. The reality is that this is not the Sanfords' house, and they have no right to claim it as such, yet they did. Does this sound like a familiar dynamic that's played out in the history of the United States?
This film is really the story of the Scotts versus the Sanfords as they try to decide how to approach rights of ownership during a crisis, how they will resolve the conflict, and ultimately whether they will choose to come together to help each other as they face a disaster unlike any other they've seen.
So you're sitting here wondering, what's the biggest and most important Easter egg that everyone missed?
We just told you, it's all in the names. Some people have caught it already. The film is really the story of the Scotts versus the Sanfords. The most important Easter egg is the deliberate choice of Scott and Sanford as the last names of these characters.
These names are meant to point us to the case of Scott v. Sanford, more commonly known as the Dred Scott case, that was heard before the Supreme Court. In this ruling in 1857, the U.S. Supreme Court stated that enslaved people were not citizens of the United States and therefore could not expect any protection from the federal government or the courts. The opinion also stated that Congress had no authority to ban slavery from a federal territory. So we don't want to have to rehash the entire Dred Scott case, but there are things that are important for you to understand in the context of analyzing this film. So remember when we told you that Clay passed that sign that said Tawny Farms while he was out trying to look for help? So that sign was a direct reference to Chief Justice Roger Taney, who was the Chief Justice who gave that opinion on the Scott v. Sanford case.
So in short, the Dred Scott case is about an enslaved person, Dred Scott, who was taken by his, quote, master from a slave state to a free slave state, North, and was returned back into slavery. And upon returned back into slavery, he sued that master because the argument was that he had been to a free territory for a certain amount of time, so that made him free.
So at the end of the day, this ruling basically said that no, if you are an African person, whether you were free or a slave, and if you were enslaved, you were not considered to be a citizen of the United States of America. And I have to say that this case is considered, or this ruling is considered to be the absolute worst ruling by constitutional experts, the worst ruling of the U.S. Supreme Court in history.
And if you know about opinions of the Supreme Court, Chief Justice Taney delivered the opinion of the court. When the court votes, one of the justices is tasked with delivering the opinion of the court. And Chief Justice delivered it, and he said all sorts of things that was just so outrageous, and making the claim that Black people are not citizens and they have no rights that any white man is bound to respect.
Right. And so this is right. And he also talked about the Missouri Compromise, said that that was unconstitutional. Like he just did a whole mess of things. So essentially what happened was, this happened in 1857. And if you know what happened after this, it's the Civil War. So it really was the reaction of the northern states to this ruling that kind of really lit the fire to start the Civil War in 1861. And it's because of this question, this issue of slavery within the United States at that time. And so essentially what happens, we all know, you know, who won the Civil War, even though some people don't believe that, you know, it was the Union, but we know how that went down. And then at the end, so we wind up with the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments to the Constitution, plus the Civil Rights Act of 1866 in an attempt to try to fix this mess. And this is not a history class, so we won't go into detail, but look those up if you want to find out. You should know. We all have seen 13th by now. You should know what this is, what these amendments were. Moving along, what does this have to do, the Dred Scott case? Why is it key to understanding this film?
A simple three-stage maneuver that could topple a country's government from within.
The film ends with GH proclaiming that they are at the beginning of the last phase of a three-pronged attack on the country that has culminated in civil war.
The first stage was isolation, setting them up for the second stage, synchronized chaos. The third stage would happen on its own, civil war, a coup d'etat.
The Dred Scott decision and its fallout contributed to fanning the flames of the issue of slavery in the United States and its ultimate resolution via the U.S. Civil War. Race and freedom were central issues to the conflict that literally tore the country apart. And when you talk about the House was being destroyed. The House was being split. And the House represents ownership and property rights, issues that were vital before what culminated in the Civil War.
And that's really what we saw in the film, too, right? They're fighting over this house. Who can stay here? Whose house is this? Should we stay here together in this house? Are we going to, you know, what's going to happen? And it should have been clear during the times of the Civil War and all of that. It should have just been clear to anybody who was present that slavery's existence in the United States was just morally repugnant. But yet there were people who were content to allow it to continue for centuries. Perhaps one of the takeaways, the ultimate takeaway, is for the viewers to look at the current climate of this country, the world, and be good enough students of history and current events to recognize a powder keg of ideological issues when we see them. We have witnessed an insurrection and an attempted coup d'etat with our own eyes. during an attempt at peaceful transfer of power in 2021 in January. We all know what that is, right? And so ideological issues related to race, culture, class, they persist now more than ever. And perhaps we should walk away from this film considering whether to unite regardless of our differences.
No matter how far this thing goes, I need to know that we're good.
So that we can all survive, or whether to remain divided and allow our differences to destroy us from within. So just to be clear, we're not suggesting like this kumbaya moment that fails to acknowledge the wrongs of the past and present, but rather having a willingness to take a step toward understanding one another on the most profound of levels and seeing the humanity in us all. Another important connection that an observation that we made was this. It's an interesting parallel between the Obamas and Dred Scott.
So Dred Scott's wife's name was Harriet Robinson before they married, and she became Harriet Scott. As you may know, Michelle Obama's maiden name is also Robinson. The Dred Scott case essentially questioned his citizenship because he was both Black of African descent and an enslaved person. Also recall that Barack Obama's natural-born citizenship was questioned both before and after he was elected the 44th president of the United States.
Why doesn't he show his birth certificate?
And it was the 14th Amendment immediately after the Civil War that gave Black people here in America citizenship. This demand to see his birth certificate was an attempt to deny his citizenship in order to disqualify him for the White House. This dynamic kind of reminds of the fight between the Scotts and the Sanford in the film as well. Speaking of names, we have another name who played a great part, meaning significant, in the lead up to the Civil War, which is Henry Clay. In everything that led up to the Civil War, you will hear about Henry Clay. He was considered the great compromiser. He was involved in the Missouri Compromise, the Compromise of 1850, the Kansas-Nebraska Act of 1854, and he was part of the great triumvirate of three congressmen who really played a big part in this. And what is Amanda's husband's name?
Clay, the great compromiser.
You're right. And another thing, the map below decks in the basement is split into fours. You had the it's a couple ways you could have this. You had the 37th parallel, which came a little later, and you had the 3630 line, which would separate the free states from the so-called slave states in the United States. And a lot of the buildup to the Civil War is whether or not the new states into the Union would be slave or free. And this led to a lot of bloodshed. So that is the split between North and South. But there's also a split about expanding west. So should states that are brought into the United States west of this line, and as you know, it's an approximation, it represents its symbolism, should they be brought into the nation as free states?
This movie is chock full of just all of this information. And, you know, when I think about it, especially about the parallels between Dred Scott and Michelle and Barack Obama and, you know, kind of this maiden name thing, is just an interesting thing. And then this question about citizenship and what does it mean in terms of this movie here, though? It's because a lot of people say, oh, this is predictive programming. This is, you know, this is, they're showing us what's going to happen. And the question is, do we really believe that they're showing us what's going to happen? Or is it putting something on our radar to say, hey, you know, here's some writing on the wall, like get things together, try to look at stuff.
We need to get to that bunker Danny told us about, and we need to get there now.
But you brought up an important point when we were discussing this about something that Rose asks her mother a question about in terms of Friends and trying to watch this last Friends episode.
Mom, two problems.
One of the characters in the movie, the little girl Rose, she was trying to watch Friends. She got to the last episode and could not see it.
One, I was literally about to start the Friends series finale, but the internet on my iPad still isn't working.
So she goes to the mother one morning and she's like, I got two problems. I'm trying to watch Friends. Internet's down. Nothing will work. And what's that thing they used to do? Because she tried to watch it on TV.
Tried to watch it on the TV because I read somewhere that they, what's it called when they used to play old things over and over again?
She's basically asked what they used to do when they played it on TV. And Amanda says, reruns.
Reruns? Why do they do that again?
Right? So this whole time, this girl is just wanting to watch the last episode of Friends because she doesn't know what happened. But we know what happened because we saw the lead up to the first Civil War. So this isn't that it's predictive programming. It's you saw this already. This is a rerun. And a lot of us know, and the kids might not know because they haven't been taught it yet, and they're not being taught this history.
Yes. And what I can tell you, too, is that we're at a time where all of this stuff about what happened back in the 1800s and everything and the turmoil in this country, those things are being actively written out of history books, actively not being taught in the schools, or they are, you know, nefariously spinning it to say that, hey, these people who were in bondage, they gained some amazing skills while they were here. And maybe we'll talk more later about some of the skills that folks came from the motherland with that they actually used here. So like they didn't need to come here to learn some skills in order to be in servitude.
Have you heard about the parallels between Lincoln and Kennedy?
I have heard some.
When we were kids, you know, we would talk about this. Oh, they were both elected in this year. One was shot here and the, you know, that sort of a thing.
Johnson.
But, so when you had the Dred Scott decision, it was 2 days after Buchanan was inaugurated, right? And the Dred Scott decision is one of those things that truly did lead to the Civil War, no doubt. But Buchanan is said to have, what's the word when you pressure? Oh, Buchanan is said to have pressured justices to come to that conclusion who weren't going to rule that way. And Buchanan, before Bush, before Trump, was considered the worst president ever. I say that because there was a time and still is a time where now we get to people who are trying to take over the government somehow, you know, January 6th. And the guy who's basically was president during that time was who many people considered the worst president ever.
So then the question that I have is, OK, so since it was a Supreme Court decision that essentially kind of really, you know, put things over the top and essentially led to the Civil War, the first one, then should we be looking to a Supreme Court case or decision or something that happens related to that in order to say, hey, you know, like this needs to be on our radar? Because I have to admit that in 2021, January of 2021, when you and I sat down and we were watching what would happen, it was almost, it was crazy because it seemed unreal.
Exactly. But we have stuff that's coming down all the time that's concerning the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act, but it doesn't have to be that. So there was a point of time where a lot of this leading up, they considered that this was all settled, right? And we kind of thought that, oh, affirmative action, Voting Rights Act is all settled, but those things are being challenged.
Roe v. Wade. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and all those sorts of things. And, you know, we're seeing some of those same parallels. So one thing that did happen was what they called Bleeding Kansas, right? Where it was like Kansas is going to come into the Union or whatever. And I don't want to get too far into it, but it was basically like a state should decide this. That's basically what the act said, the Kansas-Nebraska Act. So in the states deciding caused fighting there and, you know, a whole bunch of stuff that could be reminiscent of January 6th, right? Because they, each faction is like, hey, we're pro-slavery and we're anti-slavery. And when you see the images of January 6th, that ain't that far from an actual civil war and all the stuff. Look at how debate happens and everything here.
Well, when you see how it started, right? And I mean, had their coup d'etat been successful, things could be very different. And, you know, there is, you know, some people feel that there's fear mongering happen, but there are a lot of people who are concerned about, you know, what happens because, you know, we essentially have a rematch right now.
Yeah.
That's going to happen in 2024, as far as we can tell.
The same stuff we're talking about now, conspiracy theories, misinformation, and all of that were things that historians are things that historians talk about in the lead up to the Civil War.
Right.
Everything and that's technology and how people use telegraphs to spread their misinformation and how it advances each side and people get information about what's going on faster. The same way it's talked about in this movie with the internet and using methods such as printed leaflets, you know, to spread whatever messages you're planning to spread, or the primitive technology of, you know, I guess the broadcast alert system that they had on TV.
Yes.
This, all of these things is basically, it's no different, but it seems like it is to us, but it's right in front of us. We've saw this before. This is just a rerun.
Yeah. And, you know, I can't help but feel like part of the thing that we talk to you guys about a lot is understanding current events, understanding history. And neither of us are, you know, just, you know, constitutional scholars and experts in any particular parts of history. You know, but as you get into your, as you get older, even if you've only paid attention to current events, you're going to know history eventually, because those things will become history. Stuff that was happening when I was a kid and then I would hear it, you know, hey, that stuff is technically history now, but we shouldn't, this is the stuff you should be teaching your kids. Like, your kids should be aware of current events and stuff that's going on, because there's no way that you can decipher. And I can tell people want to decipher, because when I tell you, we sat and watched bunches, probably consumed every video that was made on this movie, the breakdowns, the Easter eggs, the whatever. And, you know, and I have to say, all of the Easter eggs that we mentioned are Easter eggs that we found, with the exception of the one that we credited to Canadian Prepper, you know, about this idea that the basement looks like a ship. Other than that, these are things you're just going to see because it's obvious right there. The signs, the, you know, the other stuff and all of the talking that everybody does. Ooh, 1619. But what does it mean? We got to be asking ourselves that question.
And, you know, when you watch the movie on the surface level, you know, because it has to make sense in both realms, that on the surface level and also once you get the hidden messages. And what I see is that you don't know what happened in the movie. Like, it just doesn't tell you who's attacking who, why, or what, right? But, you know, they had the part where the character G.H. just basically, quote, explains everything at the end and says, Civil War. And that's supposed to be telling you what happened. With the clues, that makes sense. That, hey, this is, you know, showing you how slavery up and through the decision of the Dred Scott decision led to a civil war. This is in parallel with that. And it's just showing you that there would be a civil war. And
right. And what I also heard was people saying, oh, I didn't like the movie because I hated the ending. They didn't tell us what happened, you know, because the movie ends with Rose looking at this episode. And we don't know, do they all get back together? Of course, it's highly likely that they do. Like, come on.
Yeah, they get back together. There's a civil war. You know that because it already happened in history. We just don't know who wins it.
Well, and that's the thing, right? Because if we could fast forward a little bit, then I could really put some things into context if it was like a year from now. and really a year and a month or so, because, you know, essentially the election will have already happened a year from now. And then, you know, we'll just have to wait for January
another
to roll
January
around to see, you know, what actually happens. But, I will just say that I understand if you want to watch a film and you didn't think, you thought this was something that it wasn't or whatever. But when you watch things like this and when you watch our videos, please don't come and think that it's just like going to be some light stuff. It's just, we always talk about things like this. I loved this movie. I'm obsessed with it. I'm still obsessed with this movie.
And there's so much that you can actually tie back to that pre-Civil War era. Even, you could read so much literature on teeth in the Civil War.
Yes.
Or teeth in so-called antebellum South. Everything. It's
too much to even get into. Like, we just had to do this one video to just explain the whole Dred Scott angle and try to at least explain that in a way that most people could understand it. But this isn't even a breakdown. This isn't even us going over each one of the scenes in the film or even other things that we came up with, which, I mean, we already have a couple of fan theories cooking up, you know. So there'll be more videos on this movie, but There were lots of reasons to enjoy this movie, but I'll tell you one thing that I do. When we got to the end of this movie, you said, as the blue light came on to Rose's face, you were like, it's going to end with the Friends theme song. And then I was like, huh. And then I just sat with it for a second. And then the next day, I mean, you know.
And then when it ended, I said, this is whack.
That was your initial thing. And mine was like, I got to figure it out. That was my thought, yeah. Right? Because I knew that there was more here. I just had to find it.
I still don't think it's that good.
And we just disagree. We disagree with it. But to me, this was like a scavenger hunt. And I watched it so many times. You know, I practically know all the dialogue at this point. But I've watched this movie so many times. And it was enjoyable to me because most movies for me are predictable. I figured them out. I don't, you know, there were so many things in this film that I was like, what's going on?
Those pieces come together. The pieces of watching TV shows, episodes, reruns, the rerun of Civil War. You know, there's a couple mentions of. You know, episodes. Amanda mentions episodes. The daughter is constantly talking about it. Ruth talks about it. Like,
and what about the lesson that what you think is important or what you think would be important isn't actually what's important? What you're looking at is the plot. Oh, cyber attack. I'm waiting for, you know, some action thing. And it's not even about that. And the filmmaker's telling you exactly what this film is about. It is about the relationships. It's about the decisions. It's about, are we going to be, you know, teaming up? Are we really coming together? Because we got to be down for one another if it's about to be civil war, right? You know, it's about those relationships. That's what the movie is. But the movie is not about the cyber attack. It doesn't even really matter who the attack, you know, agitator is.
If they haven't even know told if it's you, a cyber attack.
And there's so much that we really don't even know, because who's sending the signals? It's misinformation. We really, really don't even know.
That's right.
You know, so here we are. And for this video, I think we've said enough, more than enough. Tell us in the comments if you picked up on any of it. Now, I know some of y'all picked up on stuff. I'm pretty certain that nobody picked up on the Dred Scott thing. There's very little you can do to convince me that you were like, yeah, Dred Scott.
Yeah.
Because people would have said it already. Yeah. Nobody has said that.
Show
at
me
the time
an earlier instance
this.
Of someone mentioning it.
It hasn't happened. And of course, we're going to have to put it everywhere so that, you know, we get time stamped as to having put this out when people get ready to trace it back. But yeah, I think it's... I loved this movie. I'm still obsessed. You're sick of me watching this movie every day. I know you are, but we'll see what the future will hold as far as what other videos we do. But I'd really like to do a breakdown of this. Let us know in the comments if you want a breakdown.
If you made it this far into this nice long reveal, type 14th floor in the comments so we'll know you're one of the real ones who stick around to the end, the last one.
And by the way, check out the number 13 in this movie. GH and Ruth lived on the 14th floor, which is probably really the 13th floor because, you know, they don't like to say 13. There were 13 characters in this movie, if you include Ruth's mother. And just remember the 13 colonies that severed the ties with the British for freedom. Isn't it ironic that the whole thing was about, hey, we want to be free. But then you got these people you'd have brought over to point comfort on the White Lion.
Hmm.